Welcome everyone to another Jags podcast, episode 33. We are so happy to be on episode 33 and not on 32 anymore. The Tennessee game is behind us. It's in the rearview mirror. That's the last we're going to mention of it. And we are looking forward to the Jets coming to Jacksonville, game 4 on the schedule. We're going to get into that, what to expect, matchups, maybe even a Twitter question or two, score predictions, bold predictions, the whole lot. Before we do that, we want to mention to everyone that we are on Twitter at Another Jags Pod, Facebook and Instagram at Another Jags Podcast, our website, anotherjagspodcast.com, YouTube. You can search Another Jags Podcast and we are there as well. So find us on all those social platforms and all that good stuff. Spread the word about this podcast. We love doing it and we really love the interaction with you all, getting the feedback that you give us. It's really incredible. It's been a lot of fun and because we love talking about the Jaguars. They're our favorite team. And we love them. Even when they lose, we love them. So let's get right into it, boys. We're here with Jason and Joey. Robert is MIA tonight, but we're going to press on without him. Talk about the Jets. Let's get right into it, guys. What do you expect from this game? It's a big game. It's a bounce back game. Bad, bad, ugly loss. You know, the last game of the quarter. What do you see happening?
I mean, I've been saying that Fournette's not going to play for the past 2 weeks, and I think he's back this week for sure. I'm pretty sure he was ready to go last week, but they held him out because they thought they could beat him without him. I think he's good to go. It definitely changes things in my mind because, again, it does give us that other offensive option of the power running game.
Now, are you on the inside? Is this some information you're getting
it's just
a hunch?
Gut feeling where I've been correct past two calls, so I'm gonna run with it. Part of the gut feeling is he looked like mad during that last game on the sidelines. Like he looked like I could have played and I wasn't allowed to. He didn't look like, dang it, I'm hurt. Too hurt to play. So I'm kind of going with that. So I think he's going to be in there. I think he's going to want to show himself. That changes things a little bit for us. But, dude, I'm almost, like, hesitant to ever make, like, a aggressive call for the Jags again. So I think we win for sure. If we don't show up for this game, then we've got serious concerns.
Come on, Joe. You got to get back on the horse.
I will, but you got to show me some more, man. I'm still deflated. I hate to say it.
I know. We all are.
I think that we win this one. I've been predicting blowouts every week. Not going to do that this week. I've been predicting Fournette's going to play every week. Not going to do that this week. I'm gun shy. About my predictions because my bold predictions have been close, but my just, you know, off the cuff predictions have been way off. I mean, this is the Jets' third away game in their first four games. So three of their first four were on the road. That's tough for anybody, especially a rookie quarterback at Sam Darnold. They're coming off losses to the Dolphins and the Browns. Not looking good. They did blow out the Lions week one, which kind of came out of nowhere. But it kind of seems like the Lions were adjusting to their new coach and all that week one. But yeah, second game in a row on the road. Jags coming out for revenge. If Fournette plays, I think it's easy. But if he doesn't, I still think we win. But that Jets defense is better than people think. The Jets defense, in my opinion, is better than the Titans defense, and I think the Titans defense is pretty good. So I think if we come out and lay an egg like we did last week, there's no telling what'll happen, but I think we win.
Is Sam Darnold a mobile quarterback?
No.
Okay, then I think we win.
Yeah, I mean, that's the one thing that makes me feel pretty good about the game is Darnold is, out of all the rookie quarterbacks, like, he's looked the worst. Like, he's not played well. And against our defense, our vaunted top-of-the-league defense, he should look really bad.
Yeah, I wouldn't go so far as to say he's played bad. I throw out any game on a Thursday night where you're the road team because it's such a disadvantage. So I don't even really consider that any sort of example of what the Jets can be or are. So I'd say he's a rookie quarterback making his third start. I don't think he actually started the first game of the season, did he, when they were playing Detroit?
I think he came in halftime maybe.
Yeah, I think McCown may have started that game. Am I wrong? Early on, I just think our defense is too good for a rookie quarterback making his fourth start of his career on the road to come in and do anything, and he's not mobile. What we have learned, if we've learned anything in the first three games, is mobile quarterbacks will give the Jaguars fits. Quarterbacks that stand in the pocket like statues, we can handle. And that's including Tom Brady and Eli Manning, who, by the way, have both won multiple Super Bowls. So I'll take a pocket passing quarterback over a mobile quarterback any day of the week for the Jaguars. I think they bounce back. I think they win. I do agree, Jason. I think this Jets defense is pretty formidable. But I just think, you know, Calais Campbell, I believe it was, maybe it was Malik, came out this week and said, we are not a team that is going to lose two in a row. I wish they had come out last week and said, we are a team that is going to win three in a row. But, you know, that's not the case. So I think they bounce back and get the winning taste back in their mouth in this game. And I think it's, I say that confidently.
Okay.
Wow. You didn't sound confident, but way to back it up with the word confident.
Did. I did. Yeah, yeah. I had to like pause. Okay. It was more for dramatic effect. I mean, I say it confidently that the Jags win this game.
Much better. Now you look at their offensive guys. I mean, their wide receivers, what, Jermaine Kearse and Quincy Inouye?
Quincy Inouye is pretty good.
Okay. But they're not like people you're really scared about. Really?
I think people should be scared of Quincy Inouye. That's what I'm saying.
With RDBs?
It depends on if they're lining 18 yards off of them or not.
Fair enough. I mean, the dude has played 145 snaps. Okay. I mean, he's their highest graded player on their entire offense. So he's good. Yeah, he's made some plays. He's definitely shown some people.
Yeah, I think he's going to be the real deal.
Yeah, I do too. Isaiah Crowell and Bilal Powell have split carries platooned right down the middle. And they're both playing pretty well.
Yeah, Crowell's like, he's 4 TDs. I mean, he's averaging 4.5 yards a carry. That's the guy that scares me, if anything. So he's pretty legit.
He burned the Jags last year, that's for sure. Yeah.
Eric Tomlinson, the guy that they let Severian Jenkins walk for, is their leading tight end. Really good run blocker. Mediocre in the passing game, but really good run blocker. The offensive line's okay. Brian Winters, Brandon Shell, our boy Kelvin Beachum. And you can't forget about Terrell Pryor. I mean, he can take the top off of any defense, so.
Well, that's a good point you just mentioned, though, is ASJ came from the Jets. If he's going to have a game, like, I want to play huge, would this be it?
Absolutely.
I mean, stick it to him?
It's not a revenge. It's more like wanting to show off.
Yeah.
You know, but I don't think he doesn't like the Jets. Actually, he's tweeted this week about them and has great respect for them.
Well, sure, but you still want to be like, hey, this is what I can do. You guys shouldn't have.
Like you want to beat your older brother.
Exactly. I don't think people have the right opinion of Safarian Jenkins. Even if he wanted to come out and prove something, his play style like doesn't allow for that. The dude like is a basketball player playing football. He runs a curl route in the middle of the field, catches the ball, and falls over.
I'm not talking about
that. There's nothing like he can do to like we saw in the Pittsburgh Monday night game, Vance McDonald. Caught a pass and stiff-armed the dude and ran 75 yards. That is not Safarian Jenkins' game. It's not what he can do.
That's what I'm talking about.
Even if he wants to have this revenge factor, which I don't, maybe it's not, he's not the kind of guy who does that. He catches the ball and falls over.
Okay, great. Well, how about 6 curl routes and a touchdown to show your old team that you got something
that's
that 60 missing.
Yards and a touchdown. That's what I thought he was going to do against the Titans. But he's got to have Blake throw it to him for that to happen. He can't make separation. He can't do that on his own. He's not going to like run a really good route and then lose the defender is what I'm saying. He has to rely on Blake throwing him a good pass. He has to rely on the other receivers around him running good routes to get him open. And he has to rely on the linebackers not covering him.
Okay,
so he has a lot of like things he's relying on other people to do for him to be good.
So he's not good.
He's good at what he does.
Which is?
Run a curl route and catch the ball, fall over.
Fall down. Sometimes he falls down in the end zone.
He's done that entire career. He's done that every. You watch a film his entire career. It's what he's always done, and that's what he is. And Blake needs that, and we need that. But he's not a guy that's going to stiff arm the dude and run 75 yards.
God, that play was amazing, though.
How does that? It's so frustrating. Like the dude pushes the dude in the face mask down to the ground, and that's not a penalty. But
he
Roethlisberger's helmet with your hand. He flops, and that's a 15-yarder.
He didn't just do that. He chucked the guy a good 5 yards, too.
Stupid.
It was awesome.
Back to the Jags.
Yeah.
Their backup tight end, Neil Sterling, used to be a Jag. Fun fact.
That's right. I remember that.
That's true.
He was terrible for us, but.
Let's get to some bold predictions. I know we're all a little nervous because we had some major bold predictions last week and just made us look like complete idiots, which, I mean, was a matter of time before we got exposed, but. Let's talk here. What are some things you guys? What can we expect? Boldly, you can say, without hesitation, so nervous.
I'm going to jump out with big bold because, again, I think Fournette's playing. I think he rushes for 50 yards, but he catches and breaks off a 30, 40 yard out of the backfield for a touchdown.
I like it.
Man, that Jets D-line is obnoxious. They're really good. Obviously, everyone knows Leonard Williams. Steve McClendon's had a really good year on the D-line this year. Mike Pennell, again, names people don't really know. Henry Anderson, but they're playing really well this year.
Once again, this is bold prediction, not like slightly above what's going
to
happen.
I know, but I wanted to go somewhere with Fournette, but I just don't think we're going to run the ball well against this team, and it sucks, but I don't think we're going to. So I'm going to say Corey Grant has over 100 yards of total offense and a touchdown.
That's bold.
That's pretty bold.
That is bold.
Yeah.
I'm going to say the defense comes angry. They see a rookie quarterback. This is one of those incentive-laden contract games, I think, for some of these guys. I'm going to say Unique finally shows up. I believe in you, Unique. And he gets 3 sacks. One of those is a strip sack. And I'm going to say Boye gets an interception. So that's 2 turnovers. They could get more, but I'm saying at least those 2 are going to happen.
Well, man, I hope that happens.
They just pride themselves on the way they play. And we talked about it in the last episode. They didn't have their best game. Whether you blame them or not, it isn't the issue. But if anything, I think they have come together this week and said, look, if we didn't think that this season is on our shoulders, this game against the Titans certainly proved that. So they're going to come out with a point to prove against a rookie quarterback. I think it's going to be a bounce-back game for the entire team. I agree. I'm a little hesitant to say Fournette's going to come out and do something big. I certainly hope he does. My goodness, I really hope he does. But I don't know. I don't know what to expect from this Jekyll and Hyde offense.
I mean, it's a great point. If anything, this team is organized, they're dedicated, and they're prideful in a good way. So if they can't come out for this game and be well-prepared from a coaching staff standpoint and a scheme standpoint, and execute and just show out in this game, we're going to have a long season.
In the 3 games that they've played, in 1 game they scored 31 points. This is the offense. In the other 2 games combined, they scored 20. Eek. So it's, what are you going to get this week? You know, who knows? The story is still being written.
Well, both Joey and my bold predictions involved running backs. So I think this is a good time to jump to a Twitter question involving our running backs.
Yeah. All right, go for it.
Okay. This is from Brent Papineau, and he's at Brent Papineau. Thank you. Someone finally makes it easy for us to read their Twitter handle.
We appreciate that.
No, yeah, kidding. Thank you. And he asks, did our offensive game plan for New England with running backs do more for our success this year because now they need to be ready for both kinds of attacks that we have? Easier to make in-game adjustments in case one attack is not working.
That's one of the best questions we've had yet.
You're pandering.
I'm not. Because I, really,
I agree, Joey.
I really like it.
I agree,
it,
yeah.
Because mainly it made me re-question my comment from the podcast before of, are we better without Fournette? But because there's some legitimate stats that back that up at that
point.
There
was until last
there was.
Game. Yeah.
But I think he's dead on with that question. Teams have to worry about 2 different Jaguars offenses when we have Fournette. Are we a power running team, or are we going to, you know, throw out the backfield with the slants and use Corey Grant more and Yeldon more? And when we don't have both of those as an option and they can focus on one or the other, we see what we saw last week. I think that Titans game would have been completely different if we'd had Fournette in there and they had to worry about both.
I agree. I think if Fournette is healthy, then our offense is so dynamic with the versatility of our running backs. I love Corey Grant in our offense as long as he doesn't have to be what he was against the Titans. He's not going to run between the tackles. Get him out with the ball in space. My favorite play they ran with him was the fake punt because that gave him the ball in space and he was one block away from turning up the sideline and making a big play. Yeah, I think that's a great point. With Fournette in, Yeldon, when Yeldon's in the game, you don't know what we're doing. That dude can do everything. You know, obviously he doesn't run the ball as well as Fournette and obviously he doesn't play with the ball in space as well as Grant, but he at any point could do either one. It makes it really hard to game plan against the Jags and I think they're going to rely on Fournette, but if he's hurt, or if he isn't rushing the ball, like, I don't think he will against the Jets. The Jets front 7 is pretty good. then we have a lot of options from our running backs if they're healthy.
Have we seen the split running back formation with Grant and Fournette this regular season that we saw be so successful in the preseason?
I think they ran it a couple times against the Giants. Yeah.
I mean, I know it's hard to gauge success in the preseason, but man, that worked so well. I don't feel like it's maybe once or twice, but yeah, not a lot.
Yeah,
I would love to see that wrinkle.
Mm-hmm.
You know, bring it back a little bit, because you're nail on the head with Grant. He is not a between the tackles runner.
No, he's lucky he didn't get hurt trying to do that. I mean, I know. Come on, man. Guy weighs like a buck 60.
Get the guy out in space and let him do what he does out there. Because when he is in space, he's one of the best running backs in the NFL. But he is not a between the tackles runner. So, Fournette is, he changes things. You can't say for certain if he had played against the Titans that we would have won that game, but I'm sure we would have. You know,
yeah.
I would believe we would have, and hopefully when we play the Titans again in Tennessee, he will be healthy and we will see a different outcome. We won't know until then.
With all that being said, horrible last week. We beat the Jets first quarter, 4-1. That's pretty strong.
3-1.
Oh, 3-1, sorry.
Yeah.
Pretty strong.
Yeah, it is. I mean, a 3-1 start is a great start. I think most teams would take that. I would be a lot happier if we had lost to the Giants or the Jets and gone 3-1.
Sure.
Just not the team that we lost to last week. But anyway, we're not talking about it. It's in the past. We're moving forward.
Yeah,
forward
you keep
thinking.
Bringing it up, James.
That's episode 32. All right. We're on 33.
Yeah, we are. That is so episode 32. We've given our bold predictions. What about our score predictions? Now we can kind of come back down to earth and be a little more realistic. Last week, I know Jason's score was 41-20. Mine was, I think, 34-6, something in that neighborhood. Joey, I don't remember what yours was. Probably wasn't paying attention.
It was 28-3.
28. So we all had some pretty lofty expectations. I have a feeling we're not going to have that type of score prediction this week. Who would like to go first?
I think I said that it was going to be either 41-20 or 6-9.
Right.
Yeah, it was going to be either one.
You were definitely on the fence.
Yeah, I was on the fence. I should have gone with my other prediction.
Right.
That's okay. You live, you learn. But I think with this game, like I said, I think the Jets defense, it's better than people think. We're going to come out and play conservative like we always do. I think we win 21-14.
Okay.
I'm going 10-7.
Really?
Wow. I hope not.
Oh,
you just said a conservative offense.
I know, but
and a good defense.
I know what I said. I'm just saying, I hope we don't win 10-7 is all I'm saying.
Hey, I still think we win, but 10-7.
I think the defense puts the ball in the end zone for us. That's a defensive touchdown. I'm going to say, be a little more confident. I'm going to say 24-13. Yeah, 24-13. Ugh. I don't want to say that, though. You know what? No, I'm not. I'm going to say 24-10. 24-10. I know that's crazy, right?
So
much different.
24 is a lot of points.
It is. It is, but...
Four times as many as last week.
That's like, what, 8 field goals?
But yeah, way better be on.
If you follow the NFL at all, it is a week-to-week league.
Yeah.
And so far this season has been a week-to-week league for the Jags, for sure. And then listen, are the Patriots that bad?
Oof.
I mean, they just lost again.
They do get Josh Gordon and Julian Edelman back this week, so let's at least wait until this week to make an assessment. I think that's fair.
Okay.
I don't think you can count the Patriots out ever if they've got Brady and Belichick. And, I mean, yeah, they look awful right now. They just got smoked by Detroit, but who knows what it's going to look like 6 weeks from now.
Yeah. And the same can be said for the Jags.
Yeah, absolutely.
You just never know. But I think they bounce back. I really do. You know, it was a terrible game. You can't be that bad across the board 2 weeks in a row. I just don't think with the caliber players they have. I still love Marone. You know, it was a bad week, but it's a new week now. And I think as much as we want Sunday to come, I think the players, at least I hope most of the players and the coaches want it to come even faster than we do. We'll see how they respond. This is gonna be a very telling game for the Jaguars from a mental standpoint. You know, we said all offseason that they're doing all the right things. They're saying all the right things. We have these leaders in the locker room. They're a team that's not going to be satisfied with what they accomplished last year. Well, this week is going to really speak to that. How do they respond when they just got embarrassed in their on their home field against their biggest division rival. How are they going to respond? And I believe with Telvin Smith, with Calais Campbell, with Leonard Fournette, with those guys, they are going to respond well. So I'm saying a 2-touchdown victory, 24-10.
Good Jags, man. I hope so.
Yeah. Not some weak pansy 10-7 prediction.
That was
call it what you will, man.
No, I know. I'm saying that to hype myself up.
I wish that I wasn't scared for this game. I wish that.
What scares you? Just last week's performance or the Jets?
Last week's performance, the fact that the Patriots might stink, and that's our one good performance so far this
year.
Even
though you just said never count them out.
I said never count them out, but all things are pointing to the fact that they're not near as good as we thought they were.
Okay.
And that's our one good showing all year. So, I mean, if you throw that as the outlier out, not as what we really think they are, then we're in trouble every game. It's going to be like that every game. Yeah, we have the talent, and we have the coaching. I mean, I don't think we should lose hardly any games, but if they're all going to be close, man, that's why they play them on Sundays. Anything can not go your way.
I tell you, this game isn't just big because of the loss that we just had against the Titans, but the week after this is a road game at arguably the hottest team in the entire league with Kansas City Chiefs. So they better get this one because who knows what's going to happen in Kansas City. It's a very tough place to play.
Yeah, we can only hope Mahomes comes down to earth between now and then.
Yeah, which I think...
He's got to at some point.
That offense is just so athletic. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, they're super
Everyone
fast.
On their team runs a 4-2.
But luckily, their defense is as bad as their offense is good, right? I mean...
I don't know.
No?
I don't think they're great. But I don't think they're... Yeah, they're not.
Yeah, we'll get to that. We'll get to that next week.
Yeah, we'll
get ahead
of ourselves.
Get to that one.
I'm just saying, like, this game means a lot because we're not playing any slouch the following week on the road.
Yeah.
So this is one that the Jags need to win. They need to win this game. And not just that, because we can go ahead and go on to this. The Titans are playing at home, but they're welcoming into their house the defending Super Bowl champion, Eagles. What do you guys see happening in that game? Carson Wentz is back?
Wentz is back, but it's his first time in a long time.
Well, he played this past Sunday.
Well, I mean, still, though. I mean, you're coming off a major injury. Can't be back in a rhythm yet. If anything, I mean, Titans D showed that they can play. So, that could go either way. I hope Titans get crushed, obviously. I mean,
if you have to pick a winner, who do you pick?
I think Philly's going to win.
Okay.
You got to remember, the Eagles haven't had Jay Ajayi or Darren Sproles. So, if they get them back against the Titans, I think they kill the Titans. Because the Titans aren't good at stopping running backs between the tackles. So if Ajayi plays, I think the Eagles run all over him. But because then that offensive line is good. But if they don't play, I think it may be end up. I mean, the Titans offense is bad. I can't see the Titans scoring more than 10 points on the Eagles either. Especially with Blaine Gabbert and concussion protocol. Who knows who they're going to sign as their backup quarterback? It's going to be some scrub who hasn't been with the team all year. That's a bad formula for an offense. And they already don't have talent there as it is. They couldn't get into the red zone against us. I mean, we couldn't either, but their offense isn't good.
I heard they were picking up Tanner Lee with his quick release.
Yeah, like we would let Tanner Lee walk. But yeah, I think the Eagles win that one, and thankfully, because we need them to beat. I'm glad we get the Eagles in London, but yeah, I think the Eagles win.
Yeah, I do too, just because there's no way I'm going to pick Tennessee to ever win a game, but especially this one. I think Wentz coming back last week was big for this week's game, you know, knock the rust off a little bit. And the guy's just so good too. I mean, he's such a good quarterback. And you're right. If they have any sort of running game, it's over. The Eagles haven't been super impressive, but you know, I think they're going to eventually get moving here, and this could be the game that does it. So I'm going to pick the Eagles to win that one. And then the next one is a intra-division game with the Texans at the Colts. And I'm going to go ahead and say Colts. I think the Colts win this game. I'm starting to wonder if the Colts, y'all are going to think I'm crazy, could end up being second in our division when it's all said and done.
I don't think that's crazy at all.
Okay.
I mean, if they can keep not having Luck have to throw the ball more than 20, 30 yards, they've been shockingly good.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he just makes that big of a difference. And Houston's a dumpster fire right now, man.
They are. If they lose this game, Houston, that is, they go to 0-4.
Yeah.
Yikes.
Even at 0-3, I mean, I think what they said, the chances of making the playoffs at that point is 2%.
Oh.
I mean, you just start getting that bad mojo in the locker room. I mean, just stuff starts falling apart. So, yeah, I'm going with the Colts on that one.
And the Colts are averaging 21 points a game. That's pretty good for the Colts, considering Andrew Luck and their lack of talent on the offense. And the Texans are just bad. I mean, Deshaun Watson has a rib injury now, which we probably could have guessed at the beginning of the year based on their terrible offensive line they have. Poor Deshaun Watson. I mean, that guy doesn't even have a chance to have a good year. He has no time in the pocket. I mean, if we know anything from last week, it's offensive line is everything. Mm-hmm. So Colts look all right. They look okay. I think they're a little weak on defense. I think they beat the Texans.
All right. So that puts the Texans, if we're right, at 0-4. It puts the Colts at 2-2. If the Titans lose, which we all think they will, that puts them at 2-2. If the Jags win, they're 3-1 and they're back in first place. As heartbroken as we are, the sky is not falling. They can get right back in first place. And I think we all would have been happy with a 3-1 start. Again, we can't count our chickens before they hatch. They haven't played the game yet, so there's no certainty. But if they win, 3-1 start the first quarter, we would have all taken. I really believed that they were going to go 4-0 to start the season. I mean, I really believe that. It just angers me that they're not, but whatever. 3-1 is, there's plenty of teams in the league that would be ecstatic with a 3-1 start.
So. With that being said, do you guys want to go back and revisit your high expectations on the outcome of the year? The whole season? I mean,
no, I'm staying at 13-3.
Until they lose two games. Until they lose more than two games, yeah. I'm not budging off of 14.
No, so. It's just that game, it was just so bad. I just can't believe that's who they are. I really can't. I mean, really,
was,
I don't.
It was as bad as New England was good. I mean, it was opposite sides of the coin. It was unbelievable.
It really, that is absolutely true. You could not have gotten a more opposite game the very next week than what they gave. I mean, hopefully, it was crazy.
Yeah. Hopefully, law of averages, we see more of what the Jags actually are this week.
I think of all the games, the best one to gauge us is the Giants game.
Yeah.
You know, it's a defensive score. Defense scored a touchdown. Offense was sputtering at times, but okay. I think we'll be a little better. But of all the games, I think that's the one that's probably the truest identity of the Jaguars. So take that for whatever it's worth.
Should Fowler get more than 17 snaps this week?
Had to bring up Fowler. We haven't talked about him in the past two podcasts. You had to throw him out there, didn't you?
We did have a Twitter question about Fowler.
Yeah.
Do you want to read that one?
Sure.
Okay. Since you brought him up, we might as well address it.
It wasn't even intentional, but I'm glad it worked out that way. This is from, I already know who it's from. All I need to read it. It's from Loves Cougars. Great Twitter name. He says, should we trade Fowler or a draft pick for a left tackle? I know the dude is playing hot, but I'm not sure there are many great tackles in free agency.
I just don't think anyone's going to trade a left tackle for Fowler. At least not one that's of any quality.
Not any better than Wells.
Right. So right. No. Simple answer, no. And even, I mean, just no. I think Wells is doing a good job.
I do too. But if you're only going to play the dude 17 snaps, that's weak, man.
Coaching.
That's weak. I mean, the dude had the best game against the Patriots of anyone on the D line, and then 17 snaps.
That's true.
That's kind of his MO. He shows out and then he disappears too. But
it's not like Ngakoue has been blowing it up like we've all said. So that's another interesting coaching point.
But he doesn't have a chance to blow up because he's only playing 17 snaps.
No, I said Ngakoue.
No, I know.
Fowler in there more and see what he can do.
Well,
you know, but
that's up to the coaches.
Yeah, not our call.
Not our call at all. But yeah, I mean, I just don't think anyone that has a left tackle that we would want or need is going to get rid of the left tackle for Fowler. Just don't think it's a realistic assumption.
Yeah, when you punch like a defensive coordinator in the face like Fowler did, you tend to get less snaps.
Man, you hate Fowler.
He's a Gator, man. I don't hate him. I hate the fact that he has punked out like he has, man.
All right.
He's going to punk out his way to $20 million next year.
Oh, he's going
to
get paid regardless. Absolutely. That makes me even more like just bitter.
We just want to apologize for our low energy. This has been a hard podcast to do. I mean, if you can't tell, we are just broken individuals.
It has been.
I had to tell myself, this is pathetic. I had to tell myself during the game, James, this does not affect your life. Like, you still have a family that you love and that loves you. You still have a job. It is not going to affect your income. I had to tell myself that because I was so bummed out in that stadium on the drive home. It's like, get a grip, man. And it's It's a few days, you know, a couple days later now, and clearly I haven't.
Well, I text you on Sunday, James, and I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was basically the same thing. Like, as an adult, is it okay that I'm this upset and depressed about that game? I was like, because I knew it was coming. I was like, I've like real life stuff like that. This should not be affecting me like it is. And it still is, man. Like, I just want Sunday to be here tomorrow so we can erase that from our memories.
Seriously. I got more texts about sorry for your Jags than I did on like on my birthday. I was just like, golly, man. Like, I tried not to. I moved on. I mean, the Vikings getting killed helped me a little bit because I think the Vikings are a good team. And them getting destroyed, I think, helped me be like, all right, everyone has a bad game. And I've seen good teams have bad games. So it happens. But I was riding the Gus bus home, the trolley from the stadium back to the beach. And there's this one fan who was wearing a Jags shirt. The most annoying voice on earth, just talking about how I'm not a Jags fan. I'm just here to support the Jags. But if they had a better quarterback than Bortles, they would be an elite team. I turned to my brother. I was like, it was too hot of a day for me to even say anything right now. I've been sitting in the sun for too long. And he just kept going and kept going. And finally, I snapped. I snapped on the bus. And I said, is Bortles supposed to catch the ball too? He's supposed to block for himself as well? He's supposed to do all these things?
Back off, man.
So I just went off, and then all of a sudden the whole bus kind of like ganged up on him because they're all Jags fans. And then I was like, all right, what am I doing? Calm down, dude. Calm down. Like, so I just kind of took a seat back and took a couple deep breaths. And
This is the worst story I've heard about the whole game. This is worse than being at the game that like we were, seeing it in person. A buddy of ours is a huge Jags fan, but doesn't live in Jacksonville. And so he recorded the game, or it was NFL replay or something where he was watching it, and he was sitting there mad, and his wife had told him, she had seen the score and said, no, don't worry, they win. Oh. The Jaguars win. So he sat and watched the entire game thinking they were going to win. And
was she trying not to ruin it for him, or was just like...
No, he was getting mad, and she was trying to like calm him down. Or something like that. But he was under the assumption the entire game, because his wife told him the Jags won, that they were going to win the game.
That's brutal.
And
can you imagine the Mariota read option at the end of the game? He's probably like, are you kidding me?
Yeah. you liar. Yeah.
That's tough, man.
Yeah, that is a brutal way to watch that game.
That actually makes me feel better.
Yeah, it does me too. Yeah.
Thanks, good, James. I'm glad. I hope that makes everyone out there feel better. But I'm going to say this really quick. The Jags play the Jets at 1 o'clock on Sunday at home. That is going to be the only football game I watch all weekend, because the U.S. Ryder Cup team is playing over in France against Europe. The Ryder Cup, if you are not a golf fan, you need to watch this anyway, because it's the best 3 days of golf you could possibly experience. I cannot wait for it. Go Team USA. Tiger had a huge win on Sunday. He's got all the momentum in the world going in to this Ryder Cup. And I'm telling you right now, people out there, you're probably rolling your eyes. Give it a chance. Watch some of the Ryder Cup, and I guarantee you will not regret it. Just not from 1 to 4 when the Jags are playing. But other than that, check it out. It's going to be awesome. Starts Friday, ends on Sunday.
So the Ryder Cup isn't a horse race?
No. No, okay. It's not. It's golf. Okay. And you're kind of getting into golf here a little bit.
Yeah.
You need to check it out.
The game.
It's a fantastic game. Sporting event, period.
Yeah. For people like Jason, who are like, I like playing, but I don't know. This is your opportunity to get to get really involved in golf, because you see the players' personalities come out. They act a totally different way, as does the crowd. It is awesome. I was standing up watching the Ryder Cup 2 years ago. It was that exciting. So,
to me, it's kind of like if you're not a soccer fan, but America's playing. And you're in the World
Cup. Like the World
Cup.
Or
if you come here, it's just way more exciting.
Except we have all the studs.
Exactly.
You know, like in the World Cup, it's like if we score a goal, like we're happy. This is like we're favored to win.
Yes.
Although the Europe team is pretty stacked. I will say that. People aren't giving them enough credit.
I'm excited. Yeah. And you can wake up, what, like 3 o'clock in the morning and watch it live?
Yeah, it's in Paris. So whatever, you know, the time difference is, it was like 6 or 7 hours. So yeah, you can do that if you want. But I can't wait. I'm so pumped for it. And just throwing that out there. Is there anything else we want to add? It's a somber mood here, but it's not going to be next week. All right, so that's going to wrap it up for the preview of the Jags-Jets. That does it. Remember, ask us some questions on social media, Twitter, Another Jags Pod, Facebook, Instagram, Another Jags Podcast. Let us know what you're thinking. Hopefully it's all good stuff next week as we recap the Jags-Jets game and look forward to the Jags-Chiefs game. that does it for us. We got through it, guys. Congratulations. We made it. Good job. As always, go Jags.